Crispin Freeman, voice actor, director, script adapter, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. He's the guy who, when you're watching an anime, his character walks into the room, starts talking, you go, oh, Crispin Freeman. You know the voice. It's in, oh, Naruto, Ghost in the Shell, Howl's Moving Castle, Ponyo, Melancholy of Haru Suzumiya. He's been Superman, Iron Man, Legolas.
We all know that you enjoy actually watching anime, but do you play video games?
I do play video games, although because my time is limited, I'm very selective in my video game playing. So I tend to take one game and then play the hell out of it, and people make fun of me because I'm still like playing Diablo 2.
I was gonna mention Diablo because you played the wizard, and I was like, that's Crispin Freeman.
Yes. The irony of Diablo 3 is that one of those selective games that I played forever was Diablo 2, and I tended to play the sorceress because I like having spell casting. And Diablo 2, you can't change the gender of your character. So I was like, okay, I'm a sorceress. And then in Diablo 3, they cast me as the wizard. And I'm like, of course, I'm the male sorceress. Like, that's how it's going to work in Diablo 3. So I was like, well, yeah, that's what I've been playing the entire time. And because I knew the game so well, as we were recording, I would make inside jokes about Diablo 2. Like, I would say things about the cow level. And they'd be like, how do you know about the cow level? I don't understand. I've been playing your game for a decade, you know? So, yeah.
There is no cow level.
Yeah. In Diablo 3, there's no cow level. But yeah, so they would laugh. I would, like, mimic Deckard Cain when, you know, when we were recording. I go, stay a while and listen. And they go like, why do you stop that?
Next question. Yes, up front.
Hi. I'm just wondering, this is something I've always wanted to ask a voice actor. Is it ever weird just to hear your voice coming out of a character's mouth? Even if it's someone who looks nothing like you. Like, especially when you first started. Like, was that just kind of weird?
It was weird the first time. Because I had been watching anime, and especially because the first big character that I did was of Goddess and Slayers. I did a small character on Slayers, a one-episode character called Prince Hallis, but he was just for that episode, and then he was done. But then when I auditioned and booked the part of Zil'Gadis, now I have a much bigger character that I'm playing. And another actor had played Zil'Gadis for the first half of the first season. So we were now recording the second half of the first season of Slayers. And so I was replacing another actor. So I had gotten used to hearing his voice come out of that character. And so when I got into the studio and started putting my voice in, and then we took a break and I sort of stood back and I had the engineers play the animation for me, and my voice is coming out of the character, yeah, it was weird. But I got used to it. And also I remember that first time, it was a big learning curve for me because I had a big battle scene. And we did the battle scene and it was okay, but it was my first time having to coordinate acting with lip flap and everything else, and so it came out all right, but I was not satisfied with it. And so I begged the director, and we actually went back and did that scene again, and I was much happier with it. And even the recording engineer was like, yeah, that sounded good. I was like, okay, all right, and I'm learning something here. I think I know what I'm doing. So yes, the first time was definitely weird. Now it's not so much weird. It's me looking at the character, listening to my voice, and saying, does it fit? Is it dialed in just the way I want to work with the character?
Is there differences between doing voice acting for anime and doing voice acting for American animation?
Absolutely. One of the big differences is that in Japan, they make the animation first, and the actors have to dub to lip flap that already exists on the video. In America, they record the actors first, the audio, and then the animators animate to those audio performances. So that, because of that different order, whether you do the audio or the visuals first, it necessitates different recording practices. So in Japan, when they do the recording of a show, they put the video up and they have all the actors in the room at the same time, and they do it like a radio play. They have like three or four mics set up. And when it's an actor's turn to speak, they slowly stand up, they get to the mic, and they do their lines, and when they're done, they recede. So it's like an old school radio play. In America, we don't really have the budget for that kind of thing. So anime in America is dubbed one person at a time, which is sort of crazy, because you're recording an entire orchestra one instrument at a time and hoping it'll all sound good together. So there's a lot, you have to depend on your director a lot to make sure that it's all going to come together. Well, so anime is a very sort of isolating recording experience. You don't hear the other actors in anime unless you are later in the schedule and the other actors have already recorded. Then you may have something to play off of, but otherwise you don't. You're acting into a vacuum. That's not the case in American animation, because in American animation, at least television animation, American television animation, they do try to record in a group. Since we're just doing audio, we don't have to match picture. So then it's like a radio play again, because we're all standing there next to each other and we're sort of trying to act off of each other. But we're not facing each other. We're standing like we were at a reading or a concert. So we've all got our music stands and we're all facing one direction towards the producers and the director who are on the other side of the glass in the control room. And so you can't turn towards your scene partner because you'll go off microphone and you'll sound weird. So you still have to perform sort of straight ahead and keep the sort of periphery of the person you're acting with next to you. But you can work off the other actors in ways that you can't do in the anime.
Next question. Sure, go ahead.
Another question I wanted to ask, what tips would you have anyone who wants to get into the industry of voice acting? Some personal experience.
I often get asked that question. Is the most common question I get asked, how do I become a voice actor? And while it is a very simple question to ask, the answer is quite complicated because it's so specific for each individual where they are in their journey, which is why I created an entire podcast about voice acting. It's called Voice Acting Mastery. You can find it at voiceactingmastery.com. I've been running the podcast now for almost 3 years. And so the podcast, I share insights on the industry. I do interviews with industry professionals, especially ones that have unique angles on voice acting. I talked to one guy who's an expert on accents. I talked to another woman who is my teacher for improv acting. And then I also take questions from call-ins from the audience for the podcast. But there's a whole blog and podcast with all the information that I try to share as much as possible. I also offer classes through the website. I offer a range of classes in Los Angeles, and I also offer classes online. So I've set up an online system so I can do voice acting workshops with people all around the world. And I've had students from Australia, New Zealand, Japan, the UK, and all over the US. That's been really wonderful. I actually just had an Australian guy with these wonderful set of deep pipes, and we worked on Bruce from Finding Nemo, the big shark. Hello, I'm Bruce. And he was just perfect. It was great. I was like, oh, you're going to be great at this. So I offer a number of classes, and then the podcast, which comes out bi-weekly, and it's a free download either from the website or you can subscribe to it on iTunes as well.
Cool.
I would imagine the second most asked question is, how did you get into it?
Ah, well, fortunately on the podcast, there's a very lengthy description of the details of how I got into it so that you can know who I am and what I'm about and where I came from. But in a nutshell, how I got into it is I began as a theatrical actor. While I had always loved animation when I was a child, I had no concept of voice actors. That wasn't in my consciousness. I was a theater actor, and my hero was Gene Kelly. I wanted to be sort of a actor, singer, dancer, triple threat. I was also raised at the opera, so I was sort of used to larger, more dramatic performances of things. And so I just got into theater when I was in high school and in college. And then after college, when I was going to grad school, I was working at a summer theater festival. All through my childhood, I had grown up watching animation, but my favorite animation was all Japanese. I didn't understand that until I hit high school. Then I sort of went back and realized, oh, you mean Speed Racer, Star Blazers, Battle of the Planets, Voltron, and Robotech are all Japanese? Like, that's when it clicked that animation could come from different countries for me. But then I lost touch with anime all through college because there was no real internet to speak of. There was an internet, but there was no World Wide Web. It was Archie, Veronica, and Usenet days. So I graduated in 94. The first Netscape browser wasn't built until 95. So there was no World Wide Web to get access to any of this content. But when I got to New York City for grad school, there was a store in New York City that sold anime on VHS tapes. And so I went and started looking at stuff, and I got back into anime once I was in New York City in grad school, and I was at a theater festival one summer where a friend of mine caught me watching anime and offered to put me in touch with a dubbing studio for anime in New York City. And my first response was, no, I don't want to do that because the dubs are not very good, and I don't want to be a part of bad dubs. But then I reconsidered because I realized that all the shows I had grown up watching had been dubbed. That was usually how people were introduced to anime, and I wanted to make that introduction as good as possible. So I reconsidered, and I called them back, and I said, okay, let me talk to them. And so they wanted a demo tape of my work. I didn't have a demo tape. I had a radio play that I was producing a radio theater company, so I sent them my radio play, which was totally the wrong thing to do. But they called me up anyway a couple weeks later. I auditioned for this show called Slayers. I booked the part of Prince Hallis. And then later, they needed to replace Sil Goddess, and I booked Sil Goddess, and it sort of took off from there.
It's very large nutshell.
It was a very large nutshell. I'm sorry. There's even more. It's like two episodes on the podcast, so there you go.
Next question, right there.
What has been your favorite voice to have done?
I don't necessarily have a favorite voice. I'm a little different from probably many actors in that my obsession is not really character. My obsession is story. So I would much rather be a small character in a really good story than the lead character in a story that's terrible. And because then I just feel bad. So my obsession has always been stories, and I love it when I get to contribute as an actor to a story that I really admire or respect. And in that vein, the two characters that I probably enjoy the most working on are Tsume from Wolf's Rain. Because Wolf's Rain was sort of a dream come true project for me. I was introduced to the Cowboy Bebop dub when I was still in New York City. So I didn't have a chance to work on the Cowboy Bebop dub because I wasn't in Los Angeles. But I moved to LA very quickly after that. Bebop was over, but this new show was coming, Wolf's Rain, and it was the same animation studio, same character designer, same musical composer, different animation director, a totally different story, but it had this mythology aspect to it that Cowboy Bebop didn't, so it really sort of tripped my tumblers on that. And then the dubbing studio in America that was working on the dub for Wolf's Rain was the same as well. So I was gonna get to work with all the people who I admired who worked on the Cowboy Bebop dub, and we're gonna talk about mythology? This can't get better. So Wolf's Rain was really a dream come true project for me, as was Howl's Moving Castle, because I had really wanted to work on a Miyazaki film. However, there aren't that many characters in Miyazaki's films that my voice is appropriate for, because Miyazaki's characters tend to be either very young, like 10, 12 years old, or they tend to be older parental or grandfather or grandmother figures. There aren't many sort of 20s, 30s, you know, leading men, romantic leads, except in Howl's Moving Castle, where there's two of them, right? And so I got to play the Prince Turnip in Howl's Moving Castle. So that was a fortuitous coincidence or synchronicity, shall we say, of being able to work on a Miyazaki film.
What was your first directing gig, and was it a difficult transition?
My first directing gig was a little anime movie called Space Travelers. And I did it in New York City. It was a little tough only because there was a wonderful man by the name of Michael Albin who had been directing in New York. He directed Record of Lotus War and a bunch of other titles for Central Park Media in New York City. Michael and I really hit off. We really admired each other. Michael had organized a studio, and there was a wonderful man there by the name of Joe DiGiorgi who was running this wonderful studio. Michael was the director and sort of the head poobah. Grand Poobah, and I was going to be the anime expert. I was going to be the one who was going to help, you know, decide which shows we're going to work on and how we're going to do them. And unfortunately, just before we're going to start working on our first show together, Michael had a heart attack and died. And so Joe, the studio owner, and I were sort of left to pick up the pieces. And Joe said, I can't do this by myself. And I said, well, I can't be there every day. But what if we split Michael's job up? You know, I can't be the director every day, but Joe, you can. Joe, you don't know this anime well, so you don't know how to adapt the scripts. I can do that. So we basically split up Michael's job and continued his work sort of without him there. And that show that we were working on, I believe, was Boogie Pop Phantom. And so I started adapting scripts. And then the first directing gig I got was Space Travelers, which was also hard because we did it right after 9/11. We were literally scheduled to do recording on Space Travelers the week after 9/11 in 2001. So getting, and the studio was up a little bit in Irvington, New York, a little bit north. You had to take the Metro North train, and they kept closing down Grand Central Station because the security was so high at the time. So sometimes it was difficult to get the actors to the studio, but overall, other than that, the process was quite wonderful. So I directed that, and then when I came to LA, I directed a little TV show called I, My, Me, Strawberry Eggs, and then I directed another show from Bondi called Scrapped Princess. And so that's pretty much the extent of my directing work in anime. The challenge is that directing is very time intensive, and a voiceover agent doesn't like it when you're unavailable for weeks at a time because you're directing a show. So you'll find that most voice actors are either primarily voice actors with maybe a little directing, or primarily directors with a little bit of voice acting. It's very hard to do both equally. You sort of have to fall down one side or the other.
So we're in a script adapter thing.
Script adapter you can do from home on your own time schedule, so you don't have to actually be in the studio doing it. You just have to make sure you don't overwork yourself, because when I started doing it, I blew out my hands because you do so much typing and manipulating, because you have to manipulate video and everything else. So the Boogie Bump Phantom, I actually hurt my, like, I got bad tendonitis in my hands, and so I had to sort of ease off. But it is totally possible to do script adapting, because you don't have to physically be any place. And now it's even easier. Back then, I had to rig up fancy things with video decks and everything to be able to do it. Now you can almost do it on an iPad. It's sort of amazing what technology allows us to do now.
To completely get off topic and go back all the way into character voice acting, what was your experience like working as Roy Harper in the Young Justice cartoon?
Well, it was a very enjoyable experience, mostly because I was very happy to work with Greg Weissman, who was the producer on the show. I had met Greg at a convention in Los Angeles in 2001, in the summer of 2001. It was a Gargoyles convention for the Disney animated series Gargoyles. And so I had met him, and I had met Greg, and he really liked my work and said, hey, if you move out to LA, I'd love to work with you. I'm doing this TV show for Disney based on the Atlantis movie. It's called Team Atlantis. I'm sure we can find a part for you. So I come out to Los Angeles, and Disney cancels the show. Well, that's all right. There was this other show called Hellsing that I started working on, and that was all right. So it was no big deal. But it took 6 years before Greg had another show to work on that we could collaborate with together, and that was Spectacular Spider-Man, where I played Electro. And then they did Young Justice, and I actually auditioned for Superboy. So I was called back for Superboy and Superman, then they very rightly chose Nolan North, who I think was a better choice for that character, and they cast me as Red Arrow, Speedy, and I was like, oh yeah, I'm totally Speedy Red Arrow. So it's always very satisfying when you're cast properly, because then you can really knock it out of the park. But if you are cast improperly, it doesn't matter how good an actor you are, you cannot win. If you're shooting Lord of the Rings and you cast me as Gandalf, it's just not going to work. It doesn't matter how good an actor I am, I'm just not old enough to play Gandalf. And so that's always the concern as an actor, so you don't want to be horribly miscast, because then failure is inevitable. So when Speedy showed up and we started working on the show, and it was like, oh, you mean he's like the angry, bitter sidekick who's all, oh yeah, okay, bring it on, we got this. So it was quite enjoyable. What was frustrating was that if you know the first season, the question is that there's a spy in the group, and no one knows who the spy is. And you know, spoilers. I'm the spy. I'm the mole, right? But they didn't tell me. So we get the last two scripts of this first season, episode 25 and 26, and I'm reading, and at the end of 25, my character goes, I'm the mole. And I went, no, I'm not. I'm totally not. Wait a minute. And I had to read the next episode, and I came to the next day, and I was like, Greg, why didn't you tell me I was the mole? And he's like, well, we didn't want you, you know, we didn't want it to affect your performance. And I'm like, I'm not the audience. I'm the actor. I'm trying to help you make this show. You got to tell me these things. So that was a little frustrating, but that's all right. That's all right. I forgive. But no, it was very enjoyable working on the show with them.
We would all love to pick Mr. Freeman's brain for hours on end. I'm sure that we have time for one more question. And the young lady in the green hat already had her.
Okay.
Did you have like a favorite voice actor, like an inspiration?
Excuse me. You know, I didn't have a favorite voice actor when I was young, because I wasn't aware of that. I was aware of stories. And I was had a passion for animation. But now thinking back on it, I realized that if I did have a favorite voice actor, it would probably be the voice actors from the animated film of The Hobbit. Back in the 70s, Rankin Bass did a fantastically wonderful fairy tale version of The Hobbit, which ironically is much closer to the original book than the new live-action films, which are like completely random. It's like, oh, it's the Hobbit mosaic. We'll just throw everything and make it Hobbit chop suey. But the original Rankin-Bass actually hews very closely to the original book, especially in structure. And I realize now that the performances in that film really affected me as a child, and I still carry them with me today. I actually have The Hobbit on my iPad. But the performances that really affect me to this day are Brother Theodore playing Gollum. All props to Andy Serkis, his Gollum is great. But Brother Theodore's Gollum in that animated film is terrifying. It is so disturbing what he is doing as Gollum in that film. It gave me nightmares as a child. Also, Hans Conried as Thorin Oakenshield is fantastic. Hans also played Hook, Captain Hook, in Disney's Peter Pan. And one of the greatest compliments I got is that someone said that I reminded them of a young Hans Conried. And I was like, oh, thank you. I like that. But everybody in that film, John Huston as Gandalf, wonderful. And Smaug in, again, props to Benedict Cumberbatch, he's great. But I can't remember the actor's name who played Smaug in the original Rankin-Bass. But I was playing the video, and my mother was sitting next to me, and she went, "That's Paladin from Have Gun Will Travel." And I didn't even know that. She recognized his voice from the old television show, the old Western, Have Gun Will Travel, and that it was Paladin, the actor who played Paladin. And when I listened to it, I was like, oh yeah, and he's so massive as Smaug. He just has this hulking voice that is so satisfying. So I really like the performances in The Hobbit, and they certainly influenced me a lot.
Please join me in thanking Mr. Freeman. Thank you.